happened to walk in here one morning and absolutely fell in love with the sermon that I heard, and came back the next week and my heart was touched just as much as the week before. And so I continued coming to St. Andrews and have made into the family here. And just tell you who I was. So I just want to start off today just letting you listen to a verse that has kind of guided my entire life, and I'll kind of go into a little bit about my story. And it's something that I think about each and every day, and it's just that the joy of the Lord is my strength. I'd like to just begin. When I was I was 4 months old, my dad passed away, and so my mom continued raising my two brothers and sister and I as just a single mom, and that's just kind of a little bit of an importance early on. And then when I was 5, my family, my older brother and my mom and I, we were in a car accident, and I was in the back seat, and I didn't have my shoulder strap on, I just had my belt strap on, and so I ended up fracturing my spinal cord, and so I have a complete injury. I'm a T12 paraplegic, which just means I have no feeling or use of my legs, and so that's why I'm in the wheelchair. I grew up in a very small town in eastern Washington. There are 800 people in my town, and so it was pretty small. And I was injured when I was in kindergarten, and so everybody kind of just grew around me being in a wheelchair. I was the only one most of the day didn't see me in a wheelchair. And so I grew up in that environment, always encouraged to play with my friends. I didn't really have like a group of other disabled people to like more grow up with, and so I was kind of with everybody else, all the other kids, which was a big part of growing me into being independent. I began playing sports in third grade. I joined the basketball team at my school with all the able-bodied kids, and it was my kind of first sight of being at seeing myself as being different. And it was not easy for me to play. I was always like the slowest one on the court. And like I think that was the beginning of like a little bit of disparity. Like I finally saw like, oh, I am different than everybody else. This is not so great. But then in fourth grade the next year, my family and I learned from Shriners Hospital that there was a wheelchair basketball team up in Spokane, which was an hour from my house in Washington. And so my mom and I went up and tried it out, and it was absolutely eye-opening. I saw kids all around me in wheelchairs, playing basketball, doing sports, and I had the most amazing experience that time. And then I remember feeling, you know, feeling actually blessed, like, holy cow, this is so cool. I'm getting to play wheelchair basketball. Like, I don't know, it was different than regular basketball. So it was a really opening, a heart-opening experience, and seeing like God had given me this gift that I could tell my friends, like, I played wheelchair basketball. Like, it was really and so from there, I joined their wheelchair track team. And so my family would take me up to Spokane about 3 times a week for different practices. And I moved into high school, and I ended up making a U.S. team to go to Ireland for 2 weeks to compete in all track events. I was sort of unique. I did everything from the 100 meters to the 5,000 meters and shot put, javelin, and discus. And so I was just competing there. It was my first experience at seeing wheelchair sports in the world. And I ended up next year making a team going to South Africa as well for the same organization. It was like a junior world's disabled athletics program. And throughout these two experiences, God really opened my heart to see not only myself as a person that's able to compete across different cultures, especially in South Africa, like when we would drive through villages where there's a lot of poverty and still seeing kids with disabilities there playing and wanting to compete and being supported by the communities. And just what God does through what seems like a challenge, but turning it into allowing them to see that, oh, they have a goal too, they have a dream. And I don't know, that's something that's stuck in my heart. That instead of seeing people with differences, I saw people as people and having common experiences. And that's been something that I notice almost every day. And one of the things that I think especially I noticed was that there are people who look at other people and see their challenges and look down on them, but wonder what changes happen when you look at them with affection and looking at them with love, which is what I grew up with in the small community that I was in. And it kind of restructured my way of treating others as having more affection and love and inspiration, as they inspired me to be more me being able to inspire them to go after their goals. And so that was just a big part of like growing me into the person I was in high school. And then something happened in 2007. I actually ended up getting a sports injury from playing basketball that put me on bed rest for an entire year. It was my junior year, happened in February after a basketball tournament. And that was the year, actually it was 2008, sorry. And so I came home, I went back to the hospital almost every week because I just wasn't getting over this infection. And that summer were the Beijing Paralympic Trials. And so that had been a huge dream of mine, was to go to the Paralympics someday. And I watched my friends and teammates go to trials, and one of my friends actually, she made the Beijing team, and she was younger than me, and I was kind of torn. I was super excited for her, and yet at the same time, just wondering, you know, God, why did you bring this on this year? Like, it was a really hard time for me. But through that year, being on bed rest, gave me a lot of time to read, and one thing I did was I read through the entire Bible for the first time. I had daily devotions, but never really sat down and read straight through. And it was a most incredible experience for me. It slowed down my life, and reading through the Old Testament really brought me understanding God's presence in the world, and how the world has reacted to God's presence, and the ups and downs that happen when you fall away from God and you start focusing on yourself and what you want to do, as the Israelites went through time and time again. And I saw that in my own life, how I had been blessed with such an opportunity to have the sports program that I was a part of. And I felt as though God was showing me that, you know, I am still your God. I'm still with you. Just keep your eyes on me. Even when I bring you into this great new place of flowing milk and honey, you have to remember that I'm here and that I brought you here. So it was a great experience for me in the struggle that I wasn't able to compete in the Paralympic Trials, but yet that I saw that God was present, and that through everything he was still with me, and that he was still going to do great things, as I had seen his faithfulness through that time of reading and reflection and devotions. And one thing he especially showed me through that was seeing my body differently as something that needs to be maintained well, that I've been taking for granted. And so that brought me to the next area of my life, which was focusing more on nutrition and sports nutrition, and has really strengthened me in a lot of ways. And so that was pretty excellent revelation at that time. So then I graduated, and it had been my dream to go to the University of Illinois, because of the phenomenal wheelchair sports program that we have here. I don't know if any of you know, but there is a wheelchair basketball and wheelchair track program here that is filled with different Paralympians and world champions and medalists and record holders. And it's just, as you grow up in a wheelchair sports life, you just hear about the Brazilian light. And it was my dream to come here, but it was far too expensive being out of state. And I ended up going to a school in Montana. And people who had seen me growing up doing sports saw me go to Ireland, South Africa, they're like, oh, you're going to a tiny school in Montana? Like, this is the end. Like, we thought you had so much potential. And so as a sort of setback, even my coach, I remember when she called me in the winter, she was like, so, are you sure? You're like, what's going on? Are you still wanting to be competitive someday? And all throughout this time, I had not had a team to train with there, but something kept me going to the gym every morning at 6, the football team would be in there. I'd go and swim at the pool, and there's something that God just gave me, this desire for exercise and wanting to be strong and enjoy that. And so I knew that it seemed like a challenge, that I wasn't at the place that I thought would be a straight line for athletic success or something, but that He was growing me into learning how to become disciplined and to rely on the joy that He would give me, not on something that would be more set in stone, like you're on a sports team, like this is what you'll do, but I feel like He was growing me into really have a love and a joy for it that I think real athletes need to have. And so, although it seemed like a challenge, being in a tiny school in Montana where I was the only person in a wheelchair again, it was a school, campus of 1,400 people, but yet, He was continuing me on this goal path that He had shown me and strengthening me through all these challenges and showing me again the presence of Him and His reality and His faithfulness as the rest of the Israelite, keeping your eyes on Him through things that seem hard and that He's going to continue to put you in the place that He has for you. And so the joy of the Lord at that time, again, was my strength. And so one verse that came to my mind throughout this time was 1 Timothy 6:21. It says, but you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your God your confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the sight of God, who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in His own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives an unapproachable life, whom no one has seen or can see, to Him be honor and might forever. Amen. And so that just came to my mind as I was looking over, you know, what would guide me. It was just living in righteousness and the God who is the ruler of rulers and the King of kings, and just the joy that He brings us. So now, I was full of this joyous strength that came from God, because I really was full of joy, and I do believe that that's what's given me strength in things that seem as challenges or that were actual competitions. I had learned from experiences overseas, seeing people as people, understanding God's presence and faithfulness, a desire to radiate Him and to be filled by Him, and then the discipline and accountability to the Lord, who is the righteous judge. And that next year, I got a call from the athletic coach here saying that they were able to offer me a full ride. I wanted to come here for everything we paid for, including like books and every single thing. And I absolutely couldn't believe it. I still remember that call. And so I quickly wrote a couple essays and applied to get into school. And I was able to get into the dietetics program here, which was always also been my dream goal. And there's a great school for that. So I came over last fall. And one thing that we do on the wheelchair track team here that every new freshman does is you do the Chicago Marathon because we're locals. And so I started training for that. I've never done And it turned out that I qualified for the Boston Marathon. And so I was like, oh, that's cool. Like, I didn't really know what to expect. And then we got to Boston in April, and it was the most beautiful day. It was 80 degrees. I pushed by myself. I'm used to that. A lot of strategy is getting into a good draft with people to even work together in a marathon especially. And I'm just one of those people. I have struggles getting into drafts, but just chug along on my own. And throughout that marathon, I pushed myself to being in less than a minute of hitting a U.S. standard to be on the Paralympic team. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's kind of exciting. And my coach saw that, and he's like, I think that you should come to Scaroni Marathon with us, which is a marathon that's in Minnesota in June. I was like, all right, cool. I was just like loving this whole marathon thing. And so in Minnesota, it was June 14. I went over with three other guys on my team, and I pushed by myself that day as well. But I was just thinking the whole time, you know, this is just the joy. Like, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And that's what I tell myself during a marathon. Like, it does get really hard, and your arms want to give out. And I just tell myself, like, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And he's just so joy-giving. Like, I just look around me in nature, especially being outside. And I actually was able to qualify for the U.S. Paralympic team that day, going to London as the number 5th spot for the women marathoners. And it was an incredible realization when I got announced to be on that team. And I just saw, you know, a marathon seems like a challenge, obviously. And God took that challenge and struggle, and he gave me joy out of it, and showed me his presence in it. And it was just another building block of God's faithfulness in my life. So then, this is probably what you guys are sort of most interested in. I got to London, and I was the only athlete who was just doing the marathon. And so the very last event was Sunday morning, so we had already been there for 2 weeks. Everybody the night before had mostly competed, and they were celebrating and getting ready to be done. And I was just getting my numbers on for the first time, and I was so excited to be racing. It was a record heat day for London also. It was 84 degrees that day, and sunny, and it was actually really warm. And that day was the hardest marathon I've ever done in my life. It was an 8-mile loop course instead of like a 26-mile more steady flowing course, which is what I've been used to. And so it turned out, as a loop, there was a lot of turns. There were like 64 some turns per lap, which when you're in a wheelchair, that equates to a lot of slowing down and accelerating around the turn again. And so it's kind of like 26 miles of accelerating, and that just really took it out of me. And for the first time in my life, I was almost in tears thinking, oh my gosh, I was reminding myself, people do actually die in marathons. Lord, please keep me alive today. And then it came to me, you know, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Like, look around you, and this is like you. I had no strength. Like, I really felt completely stopped my energy. I thought I was gonna die. And God just like, think of all how much joy I've given you, this life that I've given you, all that I've brought you through. And immediately, I just had strength again because I knew that God had given me so much joy in my life. And I was able to, I remember coming around Buckingham Palace the very last time, and somehow, like, I had enough joy that I had enough strength to actually have followed through with my stroke again. I was the second to last person to come in and finish, and only because the person that I beat, she had gotten 2 flat tires that day. Changed both of them and still finished within 10 seconds of me. But God is faithful, and he gave me the strength that I needed to finish with everything I could. My mom's on the finish line. She hardly ever got to see me race. So it's her first time ever being overseas, and God just gave me the strength to finish in front of her, which was really big in my own heart, to finish proving that God is good, and that God is faithful, and that he brought me there, and he saw me me through the end alive. And it was just incredible. It showed me that the marathon as life wasn't just about the prize at the end. It was about embracing God's faithfulness amidst struggles and flying on His wings and by His strength and with His joy. And it's just guided me in my life daily when there's struggles, just knowing when you feel like you have no strength, you're out of water and you can't go back, and it's 84 degrees out and you still might have 20 miles left. But that God, He fills you with strength, with His joy, and His faithfulness, as He does to the Israelites, to the time of the New Testament, to now. So, thank you for listening. And that's just a little bit about me. If you have any questions, I'd like to talk to you afterwards, please feel free. But thank you.
For sharing your story and this firm belief in a God who won't let go. We will continue singing Be Thou My Vision. This was the song that Susannah asked us to sing today.